Assalamu alaikum, good afternoon. It's a privilege to be here. And I could talk at length of how the government loves to hate us and what we should be saying, what should not be saying. But my son is sitting in the audience and he's given me some very strict instructions to stick to the script. So I'll stay there. Governor Sahab has been very, he spoke in detail and touched on a lot of subjects. I'm not going to go that route. I'm going to take a different one. You've got a lot of young people here. I'd like to discuss more on the lines of the ethos of our being. I want to talk about some things in a more abstract terms, which are abstract at one level, but very specific at another. First of all, what is my dream? My dream about Pakistan is very simple, very, very plain. I dream of a Pakistan where we can dare to dream. Let me explain, really. Who am I? My name is Mohammad Malick. I've been a journalist for 25 years and a cynic for my entire life. I've met hundreds of politicians. I mean, I wish now I hadn't met most of them. But I've met bureaucrats that reminded me more of like barracudas. I've broken bread with people who have actually broken people's backs and bones to earn a living. It was my job to meet the best and the worst. I've had the privilege and the curse of seeing life up close and personal. You must remember that movie also, Up Close and Personal. So I've been blessed with that curse. I've spent the larger part of my life in being in places where I don't belong. And rarely in the place where I actually belong, that's my home. And my family can testify to that. So what have I walked away with? It's like 13 pointer cards, 16 actually. But there's a lot more to it. There's a lot more to it. Where do I start? It was an ugly life. When you see the ugliness of life very close, at times you become too bitter, you lose your passion, and you start questioning everything. But somehow, for some strange reason, I never stopped dreaming. And I'd like to share that dream with you. But being a journalist, you know, it becomes a habit. You have to ask a question every time before you move on to something. So while I move on to my dream, I want to leave you with one question first. When was the last time you dared to dream? And also, did you ever? It's very important because we live in a society where conformity is the order of the day, where we're discouraged from questioning, from dreaming, from asking, where rights come as privileges. So that is why in a society like ours, it's very important for us to understand the importance of dreaming, of dreaming boldly. But it wasn't like this always. I mean, even if you take the period of General Ziaulak and others where they robbed the nation of the ability to think and offer an honest opinion, whether they were mandated autocracies or other things, Pakistan wasn't always like that. It was a nation of dreamers. It was built by leaders who dreamt of a country and had the audacity and the courage to find that country. It wasn't populated by ordinary people. Millions of immigrants. I mean, they were the immigrants who literally tumbled into Pakistan. And when the land that they stood on, the reality that they stood on, it tilted. The world changed and they carved out a new world out of it. So our genesis is not an insignificant one. We have a very noble beginning. We have a very strong and a brave beginning. So what happened? Where did we go wrong? But before we come to that, you know, I like to sort of think that nations are built on dreams. And I was trying to put some thoughts together, and I even took some things out just to sort of sound more impressive and intimidating by taking names like, you know, what Christopher Columbus would have thought and everything. So I put a few lines together, and that I'm going to read from here because I don't want to lose the impact. I spent 15 minutes on that. So you guys must stay with me on this. And it says, You know, I wanted to believe, I wanted to stand next to Christopher Columbus when he discovered America. And it says, like, you know, when he stumbled upon the green breast of the new world, beholding what must have seemed like the greatest of all human dreams. Excuse me, got a bad throat. For a transitory moment, he must have held his breath in the presence of this strange continent, face to face with something commensurate to his capacity for wonder. That was the beginning, perhaps, of the American dream. Of course, you're not going to talk about all the bloodshed and everything that happened later. That is also bloody history. But then all histories are. But even if you move on from there, nations have to begin as a dream. They have to begin as dreams. And they must begin with dreams. Dreams are very important, especially when you dream with your open eyes. Because the dreams are basically ideas. We can talk about at length about policies. Policies are something. Policies are pragmatic. Policies take pros and cons and everything. But dreams are pure passion. Countries, nations, they're not run by bureaucrats. They're run by passion. You can create a country. You can't create a nation. You can put a mass of people together. You can't make them into a people. There'll be a question of A identity, B identity. So what binds you together? What binds us together are dreams. Our ability to dream together, our ability to laugh together, our ability to cry together. And unless we weave ourselves into that one common dream, things don't work. Things don't gel. And the best thing about dreams is you don't have to dream big. You can dream small. Some dreams might appear insignificant to me or to others, but the essential thing is dream you must. I don't want to sound too like some Martin Luther King thing, I had a dream or you had a dream. But it's very important because the way we have been brought up, the way we have been subjected to various kinds of curricula, kinds of governance, rules and misrules, we have come out as a confused nation. In our country, arts and culture is treated as some luxury, as a waste of time. If somebody is good in science, everybody says, that's a bright kid. If somebody is going to art, they say, oh, what's wrong with this guy? What's he doing? He's throwing his life away. So we live in quite a few of inverted pyramids. That's why for me, the concept of dream is slightly different than just guy going to sleep for 8 hours and waking up and said, oh, I dreamt about the neighbors, so and so. So yeah, I'm not talking about those kind of dreams. I'm talking about more nobler kinds. Like for example, let's talk about India. We love to hate India, we love to bash India, and barring cricket, I can't accept losing to India in cricket. But short of that, I can live with India. In the 50s, they created the first Indian Institute of Technology. So they started a center, and what is the simple thing was, let's create a center of excellence, and let's start creating minds that would power the future engine of economic growth of India. 5 decades later, It's a sterling success. Today, Indians have a better career choice by staying within India than the Western capitals. In fact, the Goras and the Westerners are going to India. So what happened? In 15 years, a country that was synonymous with poverty and ignorance, today is a country that's been rated as somebody that's going to walk away with all the best jobs. What was the difference? The difference was one idea, one dream. Dream to be there. So it wasn't like dreams are bad, and I disagree with my earlier learned speaker, one of the gentlemen moderating this thing, that some dreams are bad. No dreams are bad. I've yet to see a bad dream. And even nightmares can be fixed. Our governments are nightmares. We fix them every 5 years. So it's not that the nightmares can't be fixed. We live with nightmares, we elect them every now and then. So, we have to admit that India today stands at the precipice of seeing some simple idea realized into a big dream. Why can't we do that? What's stopping us? The only thing that's stopping us is our own lack of imagination, our own abilities, and our own warped priorities or
how would you say,
when you look at the, if you take a cursory glance at our realities, yes, it appears that the dice is loaded against us. You know, it's everything goes wrong. And just to, because I don't forget, you know, like, we have visionless leaders who don't know how to lead, but they themselves are led by the force of circumstances. We only have leaders of the moment. We don't have statesmen. And at this point, I'd like to share a conversation I once had with late Nawazuddin Nasrullah Sahib. It was myself, Nusrat Javed, and some others. And it was those days when Nawaz Sharif Sahib had just carried out a successful coup against Junaid Sahib. So we were joking with Nawazuddin Sahib, and he said, you know, like, well, you know, the new blood has come in, and Junaid Sahib is gone, and look, Nawaz has done this, blah, 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 and all that. So Nawaz Sahib had a habit of, if he got irritated, he would start his answer with a Farsi sher, a Farsi verse, and if he knew it, somebody was ignorant like me who didn't know Farsi, he wouldn't translate it. Just to rub it in, nah? You ignorant little fool, he wouldn't translate it. So that's how we would judge if his mood is good or bad. So he started off with the Farsi verse, and we had no idea, but we just went like, we knocked our heads, yes, we know. And then he gave a very interesting example. And he was talking in Punjabi, but I'll do a little translation for you. And he said, if an elder of a family dies, and there's no elder there, then they take the turban or the pug, and they put it on the eldest kid, who might be 10 or 12 years old. And he said, the family gets a leader, but a head of the family, but the family doesn't get an elder. What he was saying is that there will always be leaders of the moment. Power, the vacuum is not there. You will have a prime minister, you will have a president, you will have blah, 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 all the people. But we are suffering leaders of the moment. And leaders of the moment can't dream. They can't lead or encourage their nations into lead their dreaming because they can't themselves. They can't inspire. They don't respond to situations or needs. They react to situations. So when you have leaderships that only react and can't respond, they are incapable of leading, or they're incapable of putting a larger vision to the people. That's why that's one of our biggest curses. So when I dream of a Pakistan, I dream of a Pakistan where at least I have a leadership. I mean, we have a leadership that sleeps all the time, I know that. But I'd like to have one that sort of dreams also, or capable of dreaming. So that for me is one of my biggest dreams for Pakistan. Then, we over here, the individuals, they loom larger than institutions. We have corruption shames integrity. Intellectual and religious fanaticism. It has transformed parallel and alternate narratives into such evil enemies that must be vanquished. Whereas parallel narratives and alternate and wider discussions, they can be celebrated as excellent additional sources for breeding new ideas, siring new ideologies. But for us, being different is bad. And that is only because we constrained our logics. We are not willing to open up our minds. So we are discouraging parallel and alternative narratives. And that is why we see our societies closing down, our hearts just clamping up. That needs to change. If we want to change Pakistan, that needs to change in my thing. And when that happens, I would say that the deafening silence of thought rings the loudest in this wasteland. We need to change that. We need to, and it will only change if we dare to dream. And if we dare to dream differently, that these are the changes we want. Life is a lot more than power coming to your house 10 hours a day. You can go to countries, you go to, I don't know how, if you go to Barbados, for example, if you go to Jamaica, I've been to Jamaica, it's a dirt poor place. I've never seen a happy lot of people. And it's amazing. They don't have money. They have very few things, but they're genuinely happy. Because they're free in their minds. They're free in their minds. Their hearts are opening up. We have started measuring everything in very empirical terms. I am rich because I have a big car. I'm not rich because I've read 250 books. There's somebody in this audience who's actually read 250 books in 3 months, and I'm so thoroughly impressed. I'm poor because I may make less than X amount of money. We are, our concept of poor, rich, respectable, insulted, they're totally squared. We our society has become where you're respected not on the basis of your integrity and your goodness, but your ability of how much damage or insult you can cause them. Me being a member of the media, I'm respected not because I'm a good man, an honest man, or a writing, I like to believe all that, and taking bold stances, because of my ability to damage somebody's reputation. I'm feared more than I'm respected. Is this what we want? Do we want our intellectuals or our writers or whatever to be sources of fear or sources of inspiration? Do we want to be led by people who don't know, who can't see beyond the wall? So we need to go into a mode where we start questioning our basic approach to life. We need to look beyond simple things like how many hours of power and war, how much money this minister has done. They're all real things, but we need to have a more broader approach. And that's the kind of Pakistan, frankly, I am looking for. A Pakistan that dares to just go beyond. A Pakistan where large gatherings of people are not sad gatherings. When do we gather? We gather either on a funeral, we gather when a bomb goes off, we gather for agitation. The melas are gone, the celebrations are gone, and even when we gather and there are people there, we start fearing other people. We are with our families, we look like this to the other side. God, is this guy going to make a remark? Am I going to get attention? Is there blah, blah, blah? We fear each other. Civilized societies find comfort in numbers. We have started finding numbers in comfort in solitude. That's wrong. We need to think as a people. We need to have a country where we view ourselves as one small part of a larger us. It is not happening because we've divided our lives, we've divided our approach in very small, I would say, subjects. We've become specialists in life. You know, like they have in medicine, he's a heart specialist, he's a bone specialist, he's a dentist, blah, blah, blah. I want us to be rather a general practitioner. Take a generalized view of life as well. And that, for that, we need to have some common dreams. We need to create some common things that we share. There's a difference between life and vocation. And we need to draw that distinction. And from distinction, just reminded me of Prime Minister Gilani. I'm thoroughly impressed by the man. Why are you guys laughing? We have a strange ruling elite. Their priorities are not in consonance with people's preferences. We have a prime minister who takes pride in going down for not obeying the law. He actually says, I respect the court, but I won't obey you. You know, he heads a government that's about to be bankrupt. Economically, he might go to the slammer within a few days. Economy's in the pits. And he's dressed to the tee for dinner every day. He changes 4 suits, probably $1,200 suits each. And then he talks about, and then he wears a $1,200 jacket and waves this flag, waving of the train at the railway station, the business train and all that. What duplicity. What a joke. And this in a country where 3 years, 300 million people have gone under the poverty line. That's almost 30% of the people. In a country where a child is raped every 7 hours, and that's tip of the iceberg. In a country where a mother-to-be dies every 20 minutes when she doesn't have to die. This is happening in that country. And we are all looking the other way. Should we? Or should that change? I for Pakistan that refuses to close its eyes, that sees things with open eyes and looks and dreams with open eyes and questions and dares to question. And I could have gone on with Gilani, but you know. And what do we have on the other side? Here's Mr. Gilani and the power elite and all the people that they represent, totally divorced. It's a total disconnect with the people, with the common man's realities. And what do you have? On the other side, we have the people, the common man, the youth. You know, there is a dizzying cynicism here. We're living in two separate worlds. So, we are doing shamelessly well on corruption index. The governments pay people of faith in government and governance is absolutely non-existent. It's absolutely low. We are a God-fearing country, Islamic Republic of Pakistan. But when you look around, you think God has turned his face away from this country. Probably he's even had enough of us. So who do we turn to? We can't turn to Washington. Things are not doing that good. So, and if it's a land of opportunities, apparently it's a land of opportunities for the corrupt, for the influential, for anybody who shouldn't be in any civilized society. So who is it a land of opportunities for? For dishonest civil servants? For corrupt politicians? For dubious generals? Who is it this land of opportunity for? Because we the people aren't seem to be getting much share of that. The gravy train is missing everyone of us. At least it has missed me. So I can tell you things aren't right. So where do we go? Was this Jinnah's Pakistan? I don't think so. Was it ours? Not the way it is. So what do we do about it? The time has come now. We're at a serious crossroads. The time is not whether we can afford to have a dream or whether we should dream. I think the time has come where Pakistan needs to have a dream. We need to dream. And we need to be very clear what we are dreaming for. Oscar Wilde says at one point, says, when gods want to punish you, they answer your prayers. So be very careful what you dream for. Be very careful what you wish for. What should this dream look like? At one level, it's very simple. We want everything to be good. How do we break it down, really? How do we break it down? We have to have the ability to create meaningful symbols, you know. We need to have inculcate values and ideals that are ours. What we have right now is not something we want to own up to. We need to redefine ourselves. Nepotism must give way to merit. Opportunist to opportunity. Corruption to accountability. Lawlessness to rule of law. Very simple. Hard exploitation must see to hard work. These are obvious statements of fact. These are obvious desires. But that is the only way to go about it. And that is what we have to strive for. It's not an impossible charter. We need to dream of a Pakistan that is, you know, that is not led by those whose real lives are one flight away. This dream has to be made in Pakistan and must be lived here. Not in London, not in south of France, not in Dubai. It's very important. It has to be a made in Pakistan that must be lived out in Pakistan. And the first step in my dream is not to make those people a part of our dream whose lives are 1 PK 1176 thing away or EK 931. You want to share this dream, you want to make this dream, live it out and live it here. That for me is a very basic condition of this dream. You know, when I was born, Pakistan was like what, 15 years old? Yeah, I know. I'm a young looking old man. And it was a promise that had to be fulfilled, a miracle in the making. I turned 50 last November. At that time, when Pakistan was 15, it was still confused. I turned 50, I'm clear, my country is still confused. So what do? We clear things. And we clear it in our lifetime. Because it can't go on like that. And I don't think there was ever a better way. You have a truly independent judiciary. You'll hear this talk about judicial overreach and others, but this judicial overreach is actually due to an executive underreach. Judiciary has to do things because the executive refuses to do, play its role. So you have a moment where you have a very active judiciary, you have an increasingly vociferous civil society, and you have an extremely, at times, obnoxiously aggressive media. My secret, I have a secret dream also, by the way, and that is that some of the TV anchors would stay quiet for a long period of time. That's my secret desire. And no, Javed Chaudhary is not one of them. He's giving me a dirty look. But you see, it's a perfect moment. So let's start dreaming now, this very moment. The best thing, there's never a convenient time to change status quo. There's never a convenient time. It's now. Now is the best time. The best time to stop telling, start telling the truth is now, stop lying is now. Similarly, this is the best time. So what I say is, let's start dreaming now. Down to my last 10 seconds. I have to read this, because I have promised this to my three sons. I have to read this. So you have to wait for 10 seconds. It's not some great sense of oppressive tyranny that will strike and sink Pakistan. And I want you to share this thought. Please think over it. It's a wonderful thought given to me by a friend. I value greatly. It's not some great wave of oppressive tyranny that will strike and sink Pakistan. It will sink under the weight of its dreamlessness. Think about it. It's important. And that's why I dream of a Pakistan where there is a dream worthy of the name, the Pakistani dream. I dream of a Pakistan where Zaid, Faisal and Mustafa, my three sons, could just say, I am the Pakistani dream. Where you could come from anywhere, born rich or poor, and yet be anything you want. Where you're not held hostage forever to the circumstances of your birth. Ki ameer ghareeb paida hua to ghareeb hi marega, ameer hai to nahi hai, or not by the circumstances of your birth. But anything could happen if you worked hard enough at it. Where the one thing is, I can, I will. That's the Pakistan I dream of. Thank you, and God bless Pakistan.